fine like that. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين وتابعيهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. جزاك الله خيرا، بارك الله فيك. We reached the point number 35 of the benefits of dhikr. Last time we finished number 34. This time it is 35. Benefit number 35 of the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from Al-Wabil al-Sayyib by Ibn al-Qayyim alayhi rahmatullah. He says that al-dhikr, the remembrance of Allah, makes the servant walk while he is sitting on his bed and sitting in his shop or his marketplace, and in the time of his health and the time of sickness, and the time when he is enjoying, the time when he is enjoying himself or is in a bliss, and the time of the day where ma'ash, yani the time he's living during his day, his standing, his sitting, his lying down, his travel, his residency. So there is nothing of the deeds, yani the good deeds, that can fill up, that can cover all the times and all the conditions or the cases like it, like al-dhikr. It makes you walk. Walk, what does he mean by that? Walking here, you say here. Yani to Allah and the last day, yani to the next life. Yani you are achieving regardless of your situation. You are achieving regardless of your situation. Whether you are in the shop, you are walking, you are lying down, you are sitting, whatever, you know, healthy, sick, busy, not busy. Dhikr makes you continue to walk, right? Walk and achieve, right? To a point, he said, that it makes the servant walk, walk to the akhirah, right? How do they translate that in your copy, Brother Ramadan? Huh? It makes you walk, huh? Yes. Advances. طيب. So that's basically is a good way of saying it. You know, sometimes I'd like to check what is in the books because, right? So here it makes you advance, right? It makes you advance. That's a good way of saying it, right? But the word he uses to make one walk, yusayyir. Sara is to walk, and yusayyir is to make you walk, right? So dhikr drives you, basically, leads you to the next life. And he said that there is no good deed that covers all times and conditions like a dhikr. Right? There is nothing that covers all times and conditions like a dhikr. He said to a point that it will advance you, it will make you continue to walk and achieve even while you are asleep on your bed, sleeping on your bed. So he will outrace, he will beat, you know, this path to Allah, this path to Allah, this path to paradise, path to paradise, is like a racetrack. It will come, inshallah, he will talk about this. It's like a racetrack, and the people are walking and competing in that, as to who will beat the others. He says that it makes you continue to walk on this path, even when you are asleep. He said, so he will beat and outrace the one who is awake along with awake and you know praying night prayers. Al-qaim, right? Awake, praying night prayers, but then with heedlessness, with negligence, right? You, some people, they will do that. They will stand up for prayer, but then their mind is traveling all over, right? He says that this person who is sleeping, he will be in the morning, he passed the rest of the people. He passed the rest of the people on this path, on this racetrack, while he's lying down on his bed. And that person who was awake at night, who was praying night prayer, but with heedlessness, with negligence, ghafil, with ghafla. He prays, but with ghafla, right? That person, he will be behind. In the caravan, this person who is sleeping, he will be ahead of the caravan. And this person who woke up at night and was praying, but he was negligent, he was praying with heedlessness, not with khushu', he will be at the end of the caravan. He will be at the end of the caravan. And that is the bounty of Allah. He gives it to whomever He wishes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it will come, inshallah, where He will mention that if you make wudu before going to bed, right? And then you do the adhkar and like that. If you are like this, you wouldn't move while you are asleep and make istighfar or ask Allah, except that that will be granted, right? Allah will give you what you want. This will come, inshallah. But now he will explain this piece. How is it that someone is sleeping will beat someone who is awake and praying night prayer? It has to be understood correctly, or otherwise some people will deviate regarding that. So he will explain it. He said that it was narrated from a man from the Ubbad, the worshippers, that he was a guest. He was a guest. He went and stayed as a guest with one of the worshippers too. A worshipper visiting a worshipper and staying the night with him. So that worshipper, started at night. He woke up at night and he started praying night prayer. قَامَ الْعَبْدُ لَيْلَهُ يُصَلِّي. And that man, he was lying down on his bed. So when they woke up in the morning, both of them, the worshipper was saying, the people, they passed you, they beat you in the race, they outraced you. The caravan is gone. They left you behind. سَبَقَكَ الرَّكْبُ. Or something like this, he said to him. So he told him, the one who was sleeping now, he told him, what matters, or what really matters, is not that, you know, the real issue, the real important issue, is not the one who stayed the night traveling, and he in the morning was with the caravan. أصبح مع الركب. يعني he was awake, he was at night sleeping, and in the morning he was with the caravan. They did not miss him. The caravan is walking, going on, and he was sleeping. But then in the morning, he was with them. He's telling him, the real matter, the real important matter, is not regarding the one who stayed the night traveling, and in the morning, he was with the caravan. But the matter, or the real important matter, is the one who slept. Who was sleeping, who stayed the night in his bed sleeping, and in the morning he woke up and he passed the caravan. So again, let me repeat, because I think I missed the translation in the beginning. He said that what matters is not really the one who spent the night awake traveling, spent the night awake and traveling, and in the morning he was with the caravan. Right. What really matters is the one who went to sleep, and in the morning, he's not with them. He already passed them and left them behind. Right. So, the one who's traveling, yani he means, the one who stayed awake and was praying. right? Night prayer. And this is the path to paradise, right? To the next life. So this person, he stayed the night awake, praying. And in the morning, he was with the caravan. They did not leave him behind, right? He was with the worshippers, the company of the worshippers. He's telling him that what is really amazing is the one who was asleep. And in the morning, he's not even with them. He left them behind. He passed them already. Now, he said this and the likes of it, it has mahmalun sahih. It could be understood in a correct way. It could be understood in a correct way. And mahmalun fasid. It could be understood in a wrong way. It could be understood the wrong way. So the one who understands from this that the one who is sleeping, the one who is lying down on his bed, he will beat and outrace the one who is praying night prayer, the one who is completely devoted, the one who is devout in his prayer. If somebody understands it like this, this is batil, yeah. This is invalid, this is false, right? But then he said, the way it should be understood, the correct understanding of this, or the meaning, the correct meaning that we should give this, is that this person who's lying down on his bed, he has attached his heart to his Lord Azza wa Jal. And he has made the bottom of his heart, right, is really stuck to the arsh, is stuck to the, is clinging to the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And his heart spent the night circling around the throne along with the angels. He was absent from this worldly life and whatever is in it. And something hindered him, something stopped him. There was an obstacle, a problem that stopped him from praying the night prayer. Whether that problem was pain or cold that stops him or prevents him from praying night prayer, or fear for himself, fearing that an enemy would see him and would seek him, or other than these of the excuses. So he is lying down on his bed, and in his heart there is that which Allah is most knowledgeable of it, right? And you have another one who is standing up, who praying, and qa'im, he is standing up at night, woke up, and he's praying night prayer, and he's reciting the Quran, and in his heart of the show off, riya, ujb, self-admiration, talab al-jah, seeking status and position, and seeking the praise of the people, mahmada, right, with the people, there is, of this, there is that which Allah is most knowledgeable of it. Or his heart is in a valley and his body is in another valley. His heart is in a valley and his body is in another one, another valley. Right? Alaykum salaam wa rahmatullah. So he's not focusing, he's not concentrating, there is no khushu' whatsoever. Yes, he's praying the night prayer, but there is nothing. Right? And he's so much, you know. That's why in the authentic hadith that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw once, and someone was a rope hung to the ceiling. Said, "What is this?" They said, "You know, for night prayer, if she gets tired, then she hold on to that rope." You know, to, so he said, "No, just untie it." لِيُصَلِّ أَحَدُكُمْ نَشَاطًا. Let one of you pray as long as he is active, right? So if you get tired, go to sleep. And in some another in a narration, that you do not know, yani in this narration, and you do not know that maybe you will make du'a, then you will make du'a on yourself, yani because you're so tired. Instead of making dua asking for yourself something good, you make dua against yourself. right? So like that. So then he said, there is no doubt that that person who is sleeping, he will wake up in the morning and he outraced, he beat this person who is praying the night prayer بمراحل كثيرة, with a long distance, big distance. He will pass him and leave him behind. So he said, العمل على القلوب لا على الأبدان. Right? The deed, the action is based upon what is in the heart, not, you know, what the bodies do. Right? Not what the bodies do. والمعول على الساكن لا على الأطلال. He said, what is to be given weight and to be depended upon is those who are the dwellers, not on the buildings. You know, if you visit somewhere, right? If you visit, let's say you go back home, you want to see the people, يعني, your father, your mother, your brothers, your sisters. It's not like you want to visit the building, the home that you used to live in. That's not, you know, you care about the people, not the building, right? Not the walls and the streets and so on and so forth, right? And he said, الاعتبار بالمحرك الأول. What is to be given weight is the first motivator. What motivates you, right? What makes that power for you, right? Initiates that power for you to move on, right? He said, الذكر يثير العزم الساكن. Remembrance of Allah عز وجل, it will motivate, it will entice the willpower that is idle, the will that is idle, right? And يهيج الحب المتواري, it will also entice, move, stir up the love that is hidden, the love that is hiding, or the love that is hidden. ويبعث الطلب الميت, and it will also initiate, it will initiate this seeking and longing that is dead, right? What he is saying here is that the remembrance of Allah Azza wa Jal, all of us have the will, or the willpower to worship Allah. We have love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want to seek Allah and the next life, الدار الآخرة, right? But then الذكر is what motivates, what stirs up, what initiates, what moves up and stirs up whatever that is embedded already in there, what is latent coming in there, right? Whatever is latent, the dhikr moves it up, right? It makes you move towards Allah and the next life. So back again to this point here, is that a dhikr, it will make you walk on the path, it will advance you while you are sitting on your bed. It is the one action that will make you achieve on the path to Allah, regardless of your situation, regardless of your condition that you are going through. Unlike the other actions, they need other things along with them. Some have conditions, they have pillars, they have a method, a way, but dhikr is open for all the times, even when you are sick, even when you are busy, you can still do some dhikr. It will make you continue to walk regardless of your status or condition. To a point, he said that someone will be doing deeds, But then they will do them with some sort of negligence. غفلة. But the one who is doing dhikr, he might be not doing what they are doing, the actions that they are doing, but then he will still outrace them. He will still outrace them. Because although he cannot do like they are doing, there are some obstacles in the way that stop him from doing what they are doing. But then really, his heart is really very much attached to Allah Azza wa Jal. And all of these acts of obedience, they are supposed to get you closer to Allah and make you mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if they don't, then these actions are lacking. These actions are lacking. But a dhikr, as long as you are mindful of Allah, then you are still advancing to your destination. Benefit number 36, and this is a longer benefit, right? He will expand, Ali Rahmatullah, in explaining this point. So in the copy that I have, and it took from page 113 up to page 136. That is just one benefit of dhikr, right? But this benefit, because he brings some ayat and ahadith, and he explains them very nicely and very beautifully. So I think we will try to cover this point this time and next week also. Benefit number 36, he said that a dhikr is light. الذكر is a light, نور. الذكر نور للذاكر في الدنيا. الذكر is a light for the one who remembers Allah in this worldly life. ونور له في قبره. It is a light for him in his grave. ونور له في معاده يسعى بين يديه على الصراط. It is a light for him in his next life after he is returned. And he will be walking in front of him on the path. يعني the light will be in front of him on the path, on the bridge, الصراط. So the hearts and the graves wouldn't have been lit up by anything that is like the remembrance of Allah Ta'ala. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala said, what means, is he who was dead, so we gave him life, and we made for him a light by which he walks within the people. Is he like the one who is in the darknesses? He is not coming out of them, out of these darknesses. Surah Al-An'am, ayah 122. Al-An'am, the cattle, 122. So the first one is the believer. The first one, yani here now we have two kinds of people. The one whom Allah has given him light. This is the believer. He was lit by the iman in Allah, believing in Allah, loving him, knowing him, remembering him. And the other one, the one who is dead, he is the one who is heedless, al-ghafil. He is the one who is negligent from Allah Azza wa Jal, the one who is turning away from remembering him and loving him. And the matter that really matters and success, all the success lies in the light, في النور. And sadness, all the sadness is in missing that light. الشقاء كل الشقاء في فوات هذا النور. This is why the Prophet ﷺ, he used to extremely ask Allah Azza wa Jal, his Lord, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, when he's asking him, he was asking him, and Nabi ﷺ كان يسأل, to make in his flesh, in his bones, in his nerves, in his hair, in his skin, in his hearing, in his eyesight, and from above him, from under him, from his right, from his left, from behind him, and in front of him. He is asking him light, يسأله النور, to a point that he used to say, وَاجْعَلْنِي نُورًا, and make me myself, make me a light. This is a dua when you go to the masjid, when you go to the mosque. Dua al-dhahab ila al-masjid. Su'al al-nur. So he asked his Lord tabaraka wa ta'ala to make the light in his atoms, in his body atoms, outward and inward body atoms, and to make light surrounding him from all his from all the places, from all the directions, all of his directions, and to make his person, his that, his entity, and the generality of him, all of him, his whole, يعني the that and the whole of him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, alayhi salatu wasalam, to make him a light, to make him a light. So the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal is light, Deenullah Azza wa Jal Nur, wa kitabuhu Nur, and his light, and his book is light, wa rasuluhu Nur, his messenger is light, wa daruhu allati a'addaha li awliya'ih Nurun yatala'la, and his house, that is paradise, which he prepared for his allies, is a shining light, is a shining light. And he himself, tabaraka wa ta'ala, he is the light of the heavens and the earth. وَهُوَ نُورُ السَّمَوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى. And from his names is the light. مِنْ أَسْمَائِهِ النُّورِ. And the darknesses has been lit up for the light of his face. And in the dua of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the day of At-Ta'if, when he went to the city of At-Ta'if, it says, I seek refuge with the light of your face, for which the darknesses have been lit up, and the affairs of this worldly life and the next life have been rectified. That I seek refuge with you, that your anger will befall me, or that your wrath will come down or descend upon me. And then you, up until you get pleased, yani I will please you until you get pleased. I will please you until you become pleased. And لا حول ولا قوة إلا بك. And there is no power and no ability except through you. No change and no power to change except through you. Now this hadith, there is a discussion between the scholars about its authenticity, and يعني the footnote here, it says it's not authentic. Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah has declared it to be unauthentic. There is a discussion about this hadith though, right? But the issue of the light, there are other narrations that speak about it. Now he says that Ibn Mas'ud عليه رحمة الله رضي الله عنه, Ibn Mas'ud رضي الله عنه, it is reported from him that he said that your Lord, he has no day or night. The light of the heavens and the earth is from the light of his face. And in some of the wordings of this report, the light of the heavens and earth is from the light of his face, is from the light of his face. Now also in the footnote here, it says that it has weakness in it, this narration or this report. Allah Azza wa Jal, the Shaykh goes on to say, Allah Azza wa Jal said that أشرقت الأرض بنور ربها, that the earth has been lit up by the light of its Lord. So if the Lord Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, if he comes on the day of judgment for judging between his servants, for judging between his servants, then the earth will be lit up by his light. And that day, it lighting up that day, it wouldn't be with the sun or through the sun or by the sun or nor the moon, for the sun will be put out and the moon also it will be put out. The light of it is gone. Everything will be destroyed, including the sun and the moon. And their light, it will go away. And his veil, Tabaraka wa ta'ala, his veil, Tabaraka wa ta'ala, is the light. And he mentions that Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, radiallahu anhu, he said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam stood within us with five words. He mentioned five words. So he said, surely Allah does not sleep. This is an authentic hadith, Sahih Muslim, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, surely Allah does not sleep. And it is not befitting for him to sleep. إن الله لا ينام ولا ينبغي له أن ينام. He said, he lowers down the scale and he raises it up. يخفض القسط ويرفع. The deeds of the night are raised up unto him before the day. And the deeds of the day are raised up unto him before the deeds of the night. His veil is light. This is the point. This is why he mentioned this hadith. His veil is light. If he removes his veil, then the lights of his face will burn wherever it reaches of his creation, wherever his sight will reach of his creation. Then he recited Anburika finnari wa man hawla, that blessed is the one who's in the fire and who's around it. So he says, as I said, this is in Sahih Muslim, Hadith 179. He said, then the lighting of that veil is through the light of his face. And were it not for that veil, then the lights of his face, the lights of his face, subhanahu wa ta'ala, will completely burn. His light, subhanahu wa ta'ala, will completely burn wherever his sight reaches. Now, where would his sight reach, subhanahu wa ta'ala? It would reach everywhere. So everything will be burnt out if he removes the veil from his face, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So his face is veiled with light. Is veiled with light. If he removes that veil, then everything will burn out. Everything will burn out, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, this is why when his Lord revealed himself to the mountain and he removed from the veil something that is very little, shay'an yasira, then the mountain was completely crushed. It went down, it sank in the earth. Sakha fil ard, it sank in the earth. وتدكتك, and it completely got crushed and could not stand in front of its Lord. لم يقم لربه تبارك وتعالى. And this is the meaning of the statement of Ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما in the statement of Allah تعالى, which says what means the eyesight cannot comprehend him, cannot encompass him, and he encompasses the sights or the eyesights. The eyesights of the humans, they cannot fully comprehend, they cannot fully encompass Allah Azza wa Jal. They do not encompass him. But he does, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He encompasses the people, right? Now, this is in Surah Al-An'am, Ayah 103. Surah Al-An'am, the cattle, Ayah 103. The eyesight do not encompass him, do not fully comprehend him, right? طيب. Now, the statement of Ibn Abbas, which is he wants to mention here, he said, ذلك الله عز وجل إذا تجلى بنوره لم يقم له شيء. He said, the ayah says, the eyesights do not encompass him, and he encompasses the sights, right? He said, there is Allah عز وجل. If he unveils or reveals himself with his light, then nothing would stand in front of him. Nothing would stand in front of him, not stand up to him, right? Nothing will remain if he does that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, and this is from the very subtle, beautiful understanding, badi', yani from his sharp understanding. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he has a very sharp understanding of the Quran. He was very he was an expert radiallahu anhu ardahu fil jannah. Daqiqi fitnatih is his subtle sharpness and cleverness, smartness, intelligence. How come it wouldn't be when the Prophet, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, made dua for him that Allah will teach him the interpretation or the explanation? So the Lord tabaraka wa ta'ala, he will be seen on the day of judgment with the eyes, ayanan, and with the sights of the eyes. You have sight, you see through the eyes, and you have insight, right? The insight is not through the eyes, but you understand, right? So Allah Azza wa Jal will be seen by the eyes, right? By the eyes on the day of judgment. But then, even though the believers will see him, fully comprehending and encompassing him with the eyesights is impossible. Is impossible. Yastahil. Even though they see him. They see him, but they cannot encompass him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, al-idraku amrun wara al-ru'ya. Encompassing is something that is surpassing seeing. You have seeing and you have encompassing with your eyesight. Seeing is true, you will see Allah Azza wa Jal, but encompassing him, this is impossible. This is impossible. He said, here is the sun, and to Allah belongs the best example. Here is the sun. We see it, but we do not fully comprehend it. We do not completely encompass it as it is. As it is. And not even close to that. Not even close to that. This is why Ibn Abbas, he said, radiallahu anhumat, to the one who asked him about seeing Allah Azza wa Jalla, about the seeing, and he mentioned to him this ayah that the eyesights do not encompass him. He said to him, don't you see the sky? Alasta tara sama? He said, of course. Qala afatudrikuha. He said, do you encompass it? And do you see all of it? Can you encompass all the sky by your eyesight? He said, no. Qala fallahu ta'ala a'zam wa ajal. He said, then Allah ta'ala is greater, far greater and far majestic, subhanahu wa ta'ala, than the sky. And you see the sky, which is a created thing, you see it, but you cannot fully comprehend it. You cannot fully encompass it with your eyesight. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is far greater than that. Allah Azza wa Jal has made an example, set up a parable for his light in the heart of his servant. He gave an example, a parable for that. No one would understand it, no one could comprehend it, except al-alimun, those who have knowledge, except the knowledgeable ones. and he mentions the ayah Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. Allah is the light of the heavens and the earth. The example of his light is like a niche that has in it a lamp or a wick that is lit up. That lamp or wick is in a glass, is enclosed in a glass. And the glass is as if it is a shining star. The glass is as if it is a shining star that is lit up, and that wick is lit up from a tree. Lit up from a tree that is a blessed tree. شجرة مباركة. زيتونة, it's an olive tree. لا شرقية ولا غربية, not to the east and not to the west. يكاد زيتها يضيء, its oil is about to light up. ولو لم تمسسه نار, even though fire did not touch it. نور على نور, light upon light. يهدي الله لنوره من يشاء, Allah guides to his light whomever he wishes. ويضرب الله الأمثال للناس والله بكل شيء عليم, and Allah sets forth examples or parables for the people, and Allah is all knowledgeable of everything. This is Surah An-Nur, ayah number 35. He said that Ubay ibn Ka'b رضي الله عنه said about this ayah, this is the example of his light in the heart of the Muslim. This is reported from Ubay رضي الله عنه, and in the footnote it has some weakness. This report has some weakness in it, but the Sheikh, he mentions that or refers that to Ubay رضي الله عنه. Now he says that this is the light that he has put or that he has placed in his heart, yani the heart of the believer, the light that he placed in the heart of the believer of his knowledge, love, believing in him and remembering him. It is his light that he sent down to them, through which he caused them life, he brought life to them, أحياهم به, and he made them walk by it within the people. So he's referring to the ayah that was mentioned in the previous benefit, right, or on the beginning of this benefit. The one who was dead and we gave him life, right, and we made him walk within the people with that light. He said this is the light that he sent down and he placed in the hearts of those believers, the light of believing in him, knowing him, loving him and remembering him, so on and so forth. So he made them alive by it, and he made them walk with it within the people. Its root is in their hearts. أصله في قلوبهم. Its root is in their hearts. Then its power or its substance becomes stronger and stronger, and it will increase. It will increase up to a point that it will emerge. It will show up on their faces. It will show up this strength. It will show up on their faces and on their bodies, body parts and their bodies. Even, he said, even on their clothes and on their homes. Only the one who is from the same type as they are, those believers, only those who are from the same type, they will see it. But the rest of the creation, they deny it. They say, yani, mashallah, you see some people, you see mashallah, yani, he's light. You see the light in him. The others, they, what light, what are you talking about? They don't see anything, right? Because they're not believers themselves. They don't, you know, have that quality to detect, you know, where is the light, they tell you, right? So only those who are from their type, they will see it, but the rest of the creation, they will deny it. So when the day of judgment comes, إذا كان يوم القيامة, برز ذلك النور. That light will emerge. That light will emerge and show up. And it will be to their right side. بأيمانهم. Right? To their right side. It walks in front of them. This light is in front of them. في ظلمة الجسر. In the darkness of the bridge. حتى يقطعوه. Until they pass the bridge. And they are in it according to how strong it is, how strong that light is, and how weak that light is in their hearts in this worldly life. So this light of guidance, light of faith, the light of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing Him and so on and so forth, this will be, Allah sent it down to them and placed it in their hearts in this worldly life. So with that light, they walk around, right? And this light, it becomes stronger and stronger, yani it intensifies. It intensifies according to how much light they have. So for some of them, it will show on their faces, on their body parts, on their bodies. Even, he said, on their clothes and on their homes, it will show. But then some people cannot see that. Only those who are of the same type as these people of light, they will see that light. He said, now on the day of judgment, this light will emerge and will become physical. And it will be on their right. It will be in front of them. So now on the bridge, it will be very dark. And according to how much light they have in this worldly life, they will have light in the next life. And that light will accompany them on the darkness of the bridge. On the darkness of the bridge. He said, they vary in that light according to what they used to have in this worldly life of it. Amongst them are those whose light is like the sun. So strong. Another one like the moon. Another one like the star. Another one like a lamp. Another one, he will be given a light on his toe, the biggest toe, al-ibham, so on his foot. So it will light up once, and another time it will it will be put out. Up and down, you know, it comes out and then it shuts off. Sometimes you have light to walk and then sometimes you don't have light. And if this was the condition of their light, in this life, then he will be given that on the bridge the same amount. And according to how much amount of light you have in this life, that is the amount of light you will have on the bridge, walking on the bridge. بل هو نفس نوره ظهر له عيانا. Rather, it is exactly the same light, but then it emerged for him. He sees it with his eye on the day of judgment on the bridge. He will have that same light of faith, light of guidance, light of iman in this life. He will have the same amount of it emerging as physical light on the day of judgment. And it will be helping him to walk on the darkness of the bridge. He said, and since the hypocrite, he did not have a fixed life, a fixed light in this life, but his light was outward, not inward. His light, yani the hypocrite, munafiq, he claims he's a believer, so he has outward light. But from inside, there is no light. It's complete darkness. Since this is his case, he will be given an outward light that will end up being dark and end up being vanishing and going away. Yani as they were deceiving the believers in this life, and outwardly they look like believers, but inwardly they don't have belief, they don't have faith. So they will be given outward light, but then it will shut down and they don't see anything, right? They don't see anything. Allah Azza wa Jal, He said, He set an example for this light and its place and its substance or fuel, and the carrier of that light. Allah gave the parable of al-mishkah, the niche, the niche. وهي القوة في الحائط. This is an opening in the wall. You know how they used to have an opening in the wall. You know, you imagine like something like a small window deep inside, but there is no glass. It's just covered like an opening, like a box in the wall that's open from this side. And they place the lamp in it. Why? They put it in that niche so that the light, the lamp of the light will be gathered in that cover and in that it's enclosed in there. So the light intensifies, right? It will be strong, right? So that is the niche. That is the niche. It's understood, inshallah, the niche, this opening in the wall type. So he said, this opening in the wall, he said, this is like the chest. مثل الصدر. It's like the chest. Right? And now in that niche, there is a glass or a glass enclosure. Right? A glass enclosure. And it is from the purest, the clearest, the most transparent type of glass. Hmm? To a point that it was given the example of Al-Kawkab al-Durri, the shining star. The shining star. In its clarity and its whiteness. Hmm? He said, and this is like the heart. This is like the heart. You have a niche, right? You have a niche that has glass, lamp inside, right? So now the niche is the chest. And the glass enclosure is the heart. The glass enclosure is the heart. Now, it was given the similitude of glass, zujaja, glass. That is because the material of the glass material, has combined qualities that are found in the heart of the believer. And that is three qualities. الصفاء والرقة والصلابة. The transparency, clarity and transparency, softness and hardness or being tough. Glass is clear, transparent, and it is also soft, but it is hard and tough too. Right? It is hard. Not just easily breakable, it's tough, right? Hard. So the heart of the believer, he sees the truth and guidance with his clarity and transparency. And also, it has, the heart of the believer, it has ra'fa and shafaqa, has mercy and gentleness, right? And rahmah, through this softness. And the believer also, he strives, jihad, he strives against the enemies of Allah, and he is tough with them, and he is severe, he is stern in establishing the truth. يَشْتَدُّ فِي الْحَقِّ and يَسْلُبُ فِيهِ بِصَلَابَتِهِ and he becomes hard and tough in that regard. Right? So, he said, لَا تُبْطِلُ صِفَةٌ مِنْهُ صِفَةً أُخْرَى وَلَا تُعَارِضُهَا. No quality would invalidate the other quality and it would not conflict with it. Right? You have him soft but tough too. Right? Soft but also hard. Right? He said, rather those qualities, they help one another. They help one another and they support one another. And he mentions the ayah from Surah Al-Fath 29, أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ. They are stern, tough, with the disbelievers, and they are merciful within themselves. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ. It is because of the mercy from Allah that you, that is Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, became lenient towards them. وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. If you were tough or rude and hard-hearted, then they would have split away from around you. They would have gone away. Right? They wouldn't have gathered together around you. This is Surah Ali Imran 159. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, O Prophet, strive against the disbelievers and the hypocrites and be tough with them. وَغْلُظْ عَلَيْهِمْ Be tough with them in statement. وَمَأْوَاهُمْ جَهَنَّمْ Their abode is Jahannam. وَبِئْسَ الْمَصِيرُ And what an evil end or abode. Surah At-Tawbah 73. And in one report, and this is an authentic hadith, it says, or closer to an authentic hadith, one report he said, it says, الْقُلُوبُ أَنِيَةُ اللَّهِ The hearts are the vessels of Allah Ta'ala in His earth or on His land. So the most beloved of them, of the hearts that is, to Him, they are the softest, the toughest, and the purest, or the clearest, right? The authentic hadith, the Sheikh Al-Albani authenticates hadith 1691 in the Silsila Sahiha. It says, surely Allah has vessels from the people of the earth. And the vessels of your Lord are the hearts of His pious servants. And the most beloved of them to Him are the softest and the most or the most lenient and the most gentle. The hadith, it says, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ آنِيَةٌ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ وَآنِيَةُ رَبِّكُمْ قُلُوبُ عِبَادِهِ الصَّالِحِينَ وَأَحَبُّهَا إِلَيْهِ أَلْيَنُهَا وَأَرَقُّهَا The most beloved to Him, of the hearts, that is are the hearts that are the most lenient, أَلْيَنُهَا and أَرَقُّهَا, the softest or the most gentle, right? So he said, and on the other hand, or facing this heart, you have this heart of the believer that has these three nice qualities. You have two dispraised hearts, قَلْبَانِ مَذْمُومًا فِي طَرَفَيْ نَقِيط They are on the opposite extremes, right? They are opposite extremes and conflicting with one another. One of them is the heart that is حجري, made of rock, right? Made of a rock, حجري, قاسٍ, hard, لا رحمة فيه ولا إحسان. There is no mercy in it and no kindness and no righteousness. And it has no purity, no transparency by which he sees the truth. Rather, it is a tyrant heart, it is an ignorant heart, has no knowledge of the truth and no mercy towards mankind. And the other heart is the heart that is a weak heart that he calls ma'i, watery type of heart. Has no strength in it. It has no strength in it. It does not hold up. It does not hold up. Like water, yani. He said, it accepts every image. يقبل كل صورة. Yani when you stand in front of the water, right? The pool. Or you see any picture, any image would show on that, right? And it does not have the strength to capture that picture, right? When you move away, it moves from the, it's like a mirror, right? He said, does not have this watery heart, it does not have the power to have an impact on others. ليس له قوة التأثير على غيره. And whatever mixes with it, it makes an effect on it. It changes it. Whatever gets mixed with it, it changes it. Whether it's strong, weak, good, يعني pure or impure. Or impure. طيب. So the heart of the believer is like glass. Right? The glass is transparent, so clear. It is so soft. And it is also strong in itself, right? Now the other two hearts, the one that is like a rock, right? And the other one that is so weak, like water, right? Like water. Right. Now, he said that in the glass, there is this wick of light, الفتيل. And that is the light that is on the wick. It's the flame that is on the wick. And the wick is carrying that flame on it. And that light has fuel. That light has fuel. And the fuel is from an oil. Oil that is from an olive tree. يعني oil that is pressed. يعني from the olive tree. عصرة من زيتونة. And that olive tree, he said, is in a fair place. It's not, يعني, the sun will reach that tree the beginning of the morning and the end of the day. It gets the sun throughout the day. That tree is, the place of it is a fair place where it gets the sun throughout the day. And they say that if you have the sun all day long, then the oil becomes the finest, the best, right? Depending on the location of the tree. So its oil is from the purest type of oil and the best. And it is the farthest from impurities. To a point that it is about to light up. This oil is about to light up on its own without even putting the flame, yani without starting it, without putting the flame on it. So this is the fuel for that lamp. This is the fuel for that lamp. Now he says, likewise, the fuel of the lamp of faith that is in the heart of the believer, the lamp of it is from the tree of revelation. The tree of revelation, which is the most blessed thing, which is the most blessed thing, and the farthest from deviation. Farthest from deviation. It is the tree of revelation, that is, it is justly balanced. It is justly balanced. It is fair and just and the best, right? He said it did not deviate like Judaism has deviated, nor like Christianity has deviated. Rather, it is taking a middle course between two extremes that are dispraiseworthy in everything. So this is the fuel for the lamp of faith. This is the fuel of the lamp of faith in the heart of the believer. Now he said, since that oil was so pure, to a point that it was about to light up on its own, to be illuminated on its own, then خالط النار, then it got that flame on it, it got the fire, right, the spark. So that light, now that oil became even more intensified, and you have the light of the fuel and the light of the flame itself. Light upon light. Nur ala nur. Light upon light. He said, likewise, this is how the believer is. His light, his heart is lit up. His heart is lit up. He is about to know the truth with his innate nature. Naturally, he's about to know the truth. بفطرته. And with his intellect, he would know the truth. But then he does not have fuel from himself. So the fuel has come from the revelation. جاءت مادة الوحي. The revelation. So the revelation came down and it touched his heart. It touched his heart. And the light of faith got touched, was touching his heart inside. So he increased in light. He's increased in light with the revelation. On top of the light that Allah Azza wa Jal has already created him with. Allah Azza wa Jal has created him with this light from the innate nature. Fitra. Right? So the wahi came down and made his fitra even light up even more and be illuminated. So both lights have gathered together for him, the light of revelation and the light of fitra, the innate nature. So it became nuran ala nur. It became light upon light. So he is about to speak the truth. He is about to speak the truth, even if he doesn't hear a report about it, a statement about it. Then he hears of the report, and that report would be exactly as what his innate nature has testified to. So it will be light upon light. Yani the believer, by his nature, he might know that this is the truth. He doesn't know the ayah or the hadith, but he can feel that this is what is right, that's wrong, and this is right. Then he hears an ayah or a hadith that he finds it matching exactly like he felt in the first place, because already his heart is about to figure it out on its own, right? So it will be light upon light. This is the affair of the believer. He knows the truth with his innate nature in general. Then he hears the report, yani the ayah or the hadith, coming with that in detail. So his faith, his iman, will be springing from the testimony of the revelation, al-wahi, shahadat al-wahi, and the testimony of al-fitra, the testimony of his innate nature. And then he is calling us to reflect upon the meaning of this ayah. Allahu nuru samawati wal ard. Inshallah, we'll stop here. Next time, inshallah, we will review this parable or this example that he has given, yani that he has explained in this ayah, right? The niche, right, that has a glass enclosure, that has a wick of flame inside, or a lamp, and then the fuel from the olive tree, not to the east, not to the west, right? And light upon light, right? So inshallah, we'll review this parable or this example of the light of faith in the heart of the believer, inshallah. And then we will continue with the Sheikh, inshallah.